very much. First of all, I would like to thank the organizer of this online seminars for the idea that they had and to make it possible. So in this difficult and strange period, we could continue to follow seminars. And I'm very happy to open today this section. So yes, I will speak about symbolic dynamics in urban area asteroid system. The work is joint with Jérôme Dacquen and Gabriella Pinzeri, and it is part of the ERC project Stable and Chaotic Motion in the Planetary Problem. Let me show the outline of this talk. I will give the definition of the model, and I will show how we reduce the Hamiltonian. Then we will construct a Poincaré map, and we analyze the phase space of the Poincaré map. Then in a second part of the talk, I will give some definition of covariant relation and topological horseshoe related to the symbolic dynamics, as it has been done in a paper by Ziglinski and Guidea of 2004. And finally, I will show how we construct in explicit way an horseshoe for our Poincaré map to prove the existence of symbolic dynamics in our model. And the idea of this work and this construction is comes from a recent paper by Wicks and Ziglinski of 2019. Okay, let's start with the model. We are dealing with a three-body problem. So we have three bodies interacting by the gravitational law. And the three bodies has masses M0, M1 equal to mu times M0, and M2 equal to k times m0, and the motion is constrained on a plane, so we are dealing with a planar three-body problem. Here we write the well-known Hamiltonian of the three-body problem in an orthonormal reference frame, in a generic orthonormal reference frame. We have that the positions of the bodies are given by the coordinates x0, x1, and x2, and the impulses of the bodies are given by the coordinates y0, y1, and y2. Then we want to rewrite in a most suitable way our Hamiltonian, so we do some suitable reduction and rescaling. In particular, we do a well-known Jacobi reduction, and we rescale the masses in order to have this new Hamiltonian, where we can see that appear some new mass parameters that are beta and beta bar and sigma that I wrote here. They depend on the parameters mu and k. And we have introduced new coordinates that now I will show you in a few moments. But the new coordinates are x and x prime for the position, and y, y prime for the impulses. Okay, this Hamiltonian holds for every values of the mass parameter mu and k. So it is a generic Hamiltonian. Then we want to introduce some hypotheses. So we take two of the bodies, so the two bodies, for example, P0, P1, with equal masses. So we choose as a parameter mu, we choose mu equal to 1, so that the two bodies have mass equal to M0. And we will call them the asteroids. Then we will take the second point, the third body with bigger mass. So we will, the third body will have mass KM0 with K greater than 1. So let me show the plot, the figure. We have two bodies orbit with equal masses, so they orbit around their common barycenter of mass, that is B1. So B1 is the barycenter of the two equal bodies. And the vector x, so our coordinate x, is the vector between the two bodies P0 and P1. While the position, the other vector, the other coordinate x prime, is the vector between the third body P2 and the barycenter of the first two bodies. Okay, I want to show also how the Hamiltonian will simplify in a very simple way when we take mu equal to one, because beta and beta bar became equal. We could see that beta and beta bar differ just from in the denominator by mu square and mu. So if mu is equal to one, beta and beta bar are equal. So this Hamiltonian simplifies because this coefficient becomes one. And in these two denominators, we have the same expression with a plus and a minus in these two denominators. So we could rewrite in a simple way the Hamiltonian. It is the same as before, just with the hypothesis that mu is equal to one. And we will see from the definition of beta and beta bar that beta is of the order of k, that we are choosing to be much greater than one. Now we want to introduce some new a new set of variables called lambda, capital G, capital R, and small l, small g, small r, that I will define in a moment. And a generic generic description of these variables are given in a paper by Gabriella Pinzari of 2019, where there is they are defined in more general setting, and where it is proved their canonicity. So we are using this kind of coordinates, and we define the coordinates in this way. Before we define some Delaunay coordinates for one of the asteroid with respect to the axis x prime. So I show you again the model. So we have the Keplerian orbit of, for example, one of the asteroid, and we consider P is the represent the pericenter of the problem. So small l is the mean anomaly of the asteroid, and small g is the argument of pericenter with respect to the direction of the vector x prime. Then we complete the set of coordinates with the action capital lambda capital G, where lambda is proportional to the semi-major axis A, where A is the semi-major axis of the ellipse. And then we take capital G as the angular momentum of the asteroid, and in particular is the projection of the direction perpendicular to the plane of the orbit. So we have the plane of the orbit because it is a planar motion, and we consider the projection on the perpendicular axis. Then we complete this set of coordinates with some coordinates that we call radial coordinates for the planet. I didn't say that, yes, we have called these two small bodies asteroids, and we call the third body the planet. So the radial coordinate for the planet we define as small r, the norm of the vector x prime. So it represents the distance between the planet P2 and the common barycenter B1 of the two asteroids. And then capital R, this is the action related, is a sort of radial velocity of the planet P. Then we want to add one more requirement. We want to choose just a region of the phase space. So we choose the phase space such that the norm of the coordinate x prime is greater than beta the norm of beta times x. This means that we remember that x prime is this vector, and x is the vector between the two asteroids, and moreover, beta is of the order of k. So if we ask that k is greater than one, much greater than one, we are asking that the planet is far from the two asteroids. So, and in terms of the Delaunay variables, we are asking that the variable r is greater than two times beta times a. So we are asking that the planet is EV with respect to the two asteroids, and moreover that is far from them, and his orbit is external to the orbit of the two asteroids. Here we have rewritten the Hamiltonian in the new coordinates. So we could see that we have an unperturbed part, then we have a part that we call a kinetic part that does not depend on the angle L and small g. And then we have two more terms that are that will be our perturbation, the perturbation of this problem. And here we have introduced some new variables. For example, we have introduced capital C, that is the total angular momentum of the system. Of course, the projection, also in this case, of the total angular momentum. And important things is that we have written these terms, the square root are the, in some sense, the distance between the vectors, and we are written them in terms of the, we have introduced some parameters where the eccentric anomaly appears. So we have introduced the anomaly C, the eccentric anomaly, that is related by L by means of the Kepler equation. Moreover, we have introduced also the eccentricity, which is related to the action capital lambda capital G by a well-known expression. Okay, well, what we want to do more later is to average with respect to the fast angle L. So we compute the average of the Hamiltonian with respect to the angle L. So that we get a secular problem where we could rewrite the Hamiltonian. Okay, the first two terms does not depend on L, so they remain unchanged. While the second part could be written as a function U depending on capital G, small g, and small r, where U could be written as a sum of two functions, U plus and U minus, where U plus and U minus is defined as the integral over zero to pi of the perturbing term. And they differ just on the plus and the minus under the square root. Then we also, in order to compute in an explicit way this Hamiltonian, we want to expand the problem with respect to the small quantity beta times A over R. This quantity is small because of the requirements that we have done from in the model, so that the planet is very far from the two asteroids. So we could expand this Hamiltonian, and we get, by expanding the Hamiltonian, we get an infinite sum with this form, where we have some terms depending on capital G, small g, small r, times the small quantity to the power nu, where these terms q nu could be written in an explicit way. So we could write them like in this way, m0 square over r, times a sum where we have some polynomial depending just on capital G, times the cosine of 2p small g. And this expression is true if nu is even, otherwise it is zero, and it depends from the symmetry in these two terms, where all the odd terms cancelled because they appear with opposite sign. So again, just to summarize, we start from our full problem for Hamiltonian. Explicitly, what we do, we expand Hamiltonian with respect to this small quantity, then we truncate the expansion at some order k. In our case, we take k equal to 10, and then we average this Hamiltonian, the expansion about with respect to the angle r, l, and okay, here I rewrite again the Hamiltonian, and we could we could neglect the first term appearing because it is now it is just a constant, it is a first integral. So we have the Hamiltonian like a sum of two parts, a part that we call kinetic part depending on capital G, capital R and small r, and the perturbation uk given by the expression that I said before. Now we have seen that, okay, we start from a 3 degrees of freedom Hamiltonian, and we arrive to have 2 degrees of freedom Hamiltonian, and we know that the dimension of the phase space is four dimensional phase space. And now we want to reduce the phase space, the dimension of the phase space, in order to better visualize, better analyze the problem. So we want to construct a Poincaré map. Here I explicitly will show you how we construct this Poincaré section, but it is done in a classical way. But what we've done is to find a periodic orbit in all the four variables. And so we get an initial datum for this periodic orbit. And we know that there is associated a fixed energy level that we could call H star. So we have, we could consider a three-dimensional space, capital G, capital small g, small r, and the periodic orbit is a closed curve in this three-dimensional space. So we define a section, a plane sigma, that is transversal to the orbit. In particular, we take a plane orthogonal to the initial velocity vector. So we could write in an explicit way the equation of the plane sigma in this three-dimensional space. I just want to add some information about this periodic orbit, because we choose it explicitly, and it is just one possible orbit. And the important thing is just that it satisfies the condition that we have stated before. And moreover, we ask some more hypotheses. Is that okay? If here I rewrite the Hamiltonian, adding again the unperturbed part, so it is the same as this one plus the term H0, that is the term depending just on capital lambda. So what we ask is that the perturbation is really a perturbation with respect to the terms H0 and K. So we are asking something that some constant and initial condition such that this condition is satisfied. And we found, for example, this orbit with these values of the constant, because all of them are constant, and this value of the initial condition. But it is just an example. And then we worked on this example. So then we define explicitly our Poincaré map. So we consider the map P, where starting from R2 to R2, where, okay, we take an initial couple of initial condition from capital G and small g, and we know that they belong to some dominion, and the dominion is D times the torus over 2, because okay, D, that is the domain of capital G, is an interval, a real interval between minus lambda and lambda, where lambda is this constant, and the domain of small g is zero pi, because the Hamiltonian, due to the fact that we have just even terms, the Hamiltonian is periodic by pi. So we take this initial condition, then we obtain a small r such that the triplet capital G small g small r belongs to the section, and then we obtain also capital R, and in order to get the four dimensional initial condition. One more word about R. In the Hamiltonian, R just appear with the square in this in the kinetic part. So we have to require that R is such that R square is positive, and this give our admissible domain in the variable small g and capital G, where we could see that we have to exclude some values, a set of initial condition in small g and capital G, such that R square is negative. In particular, in this plot, the set that we are excluding is this set in blue. So the all the other part in beige is the admissible domain. Then we let evolve our initial condition, our four-dimensional initial condition under the flow of the Hamiltonian, and we stop at a certain time tau, that is the time where the minimum time where the triplet capital G small g small r belongs again to the section sigma. So it is the time of the first return in the section. And then, so we take again just the couple capital G small g, and this is our image of the Poincaré map. What we have done later is to analyze the phase space of our Poincaré map. So in the plot on the right, we have plotted a grid of initial condition, a grid on the domain in small g and capital G, and we have iterated the Poincaré map many times. In particular, in this plot, we have we iterated for the order of 10 to the 3 iteration of the map P, and we could see that we have we could analyze this face portrait, seeing that in the center, in the most in the most part of the plot, we could see some regular structure with circulation of tori. In the lower part, we could see, for example, here an elliptic island and surrounded by a chaos. And we could see in this part that we have an empty zone that is the zone of the not admissible domain, where, okay, does not exist small g and capital G such that the capital R is well defined. So this is empty. And then we have in the upper part, we have a lot of points representing the chaos. On the left, sorry, on the right, we have two zooms of the plot. The upper on the upper right, we take in particular this central part. We could see that we have other elliptic island. Then there are some, also here there are some chaos constructed in a closed region that surround the elliptic island, and then we have other circulation of tori. And in the lower plot, there is a zoom of this lower part of the face space, and also here we could see that we could see better this elliptic island surrounded by a lot of chaos. Then we have also studied the hyperbolic structure of this phase space, and we found some we found the fixed points of the Poincaré map. I want to remember that a fixed point in the Poincaré map corresponds to periodic orbit in the Hamiltonian. So, okay, when we found the fixed point, then we have also studied the stability of this fixed point, and we found that we found three of these points as to be elliptic, and we could see that they are inside the elliptic island. And here, this point, it is not possible to see the island because it is very little to see, but in particular, this elliptic point corresponds to the periodic orbit that we found at the beginning, the starting periodic orbit. Then we have found many hyperbolic fixed points. Most of them are in the upper part of the plot. And we could also see that there is two hyperbolic fixed points, one in the lower part that is the origin of the chaos in the lower part. And then we found also this hyperbolic fixed point that is the one the one responsible to the chaos in this region. Okay, We have also studied the heteroclinic, the stable and the stable manifolds of the hyperbolic fixed point. In the upper plot on the right, we plot just the stable and unstable manifolds, so just one of these fixed points. In particular, it should be this one. So in blue, we plot the stable manifold, and in red, the unstable. And we could see that there are many intersections of the two manifolds. To see better the intersection,
the lower plot. One moment.
Okay, sorry, I had some problem with the microphone, but I think now it's okay. I plot the manifolds, the stable and unstable manifolds of two distinct hyperbolic fixed points, Q1 and Q2, that are these two points, close points. And again, in red, there is the two unstable manifolds, and in blue, are the two stable manifolds. And we could see that there are many intersections, in particular heteroclinic intersection of these manifolds. Okay, now we are ready to start with the part regarding the covariance relation, the symbolic dynamics. But before to continue, I want to give some definition of covariance relation and symbolic dynamics. So as I said before, these definitions are given by Zigliski and Ghidea in their paper by 2004. And then after this definition, I will show how we construct the horseshoe for the Poincaré map that we have constructed to prove the existence of symbolic dynamics in our model. Yes, the idea, again, as I said before, the idea of this construction is given by this paper by Ginsquicks and Zigliski of 2019. So let me start with the definition of covariance relation. Before I give you just some notation to understand what I mentioned. So we are considering, okay, first of all, I would say that the definition that I give to you now are all in a two-dimensional space. So we are in R2. But the definition and the theorem given by Ghidea and Zigliski are in a generic n-dimensional space. So this definition could be, they hold also in n-dimensional space. And of course, in this definition, they are simplified because we are just in R2. So if we consider a compact set of R2, we will see that it is a support of an H set if we could find an homeomorphism Cn such that the image of the set N under the homeomorphism Cn is the square minus 1 plus 1 to the square. Then we could define some other subset that is nc minus and nc plus that are the parallel edge, the two parallel and disjoint edges of the square. And we define as n minus and n plus the preimage of this edges nc minus and nc plus that we will call as exit set and entry set. So we are considering these two set and minus and plus are the preimage of the parallel and disjoint set of the square. Now we could define what a covering relation is. So let F be a continuous map and N and M be the support of two H set. Means that we could define the N minus N plus and M minus and N plus. We will say that M F cover N, and we will denote it by this expression, if these two conditions are satisfied. This condition means that the first one say that the intersection between the image of M minus, that is, okay, in this plot we could see that this rectangle is N, this is N, M, and this is the image of M under the map F. So the first condition say that the intersection between the image of FM, that is this two blue segment, intersect with all the set N, is empty. And it is called exit condition. The second condition say that all the image of FM, so the all this set, intersected with N plus, that is these two edges in red, should be empty. And this is the entry condition. The covering relation could be given also as a self-covering relation when these two conditions are satisfied for the set itself. So we will say that N F cover itself if something like this appears. That means that the image of Fn should be inside the top and the bottom edge of the set N, and also that the images of Fn, that we have two of them, one on the left and one on the right, it should be to be respectively on the left and on the right of the set N minus. Okay, now we could give also the definition of topological horseshoe, and we will see that let be N1 and N2 the supports of two disjoint H sets in R2. We will see that the map F is a topological horseshoe for these two sets if these four F covering relation are satisfied, so that N1 has to cover itself, N1 has to cover N2, and vice versa, N2 has to cover N1, and N2 has to cover itself. So also in this case, we could explain this relation between this plot where we have two sets and N2, we have the two images inside the strip between the entry set that are in red, and the images of the exit set that are in blue has to be both on the left and on the right. Okay, now also we want to relate the topological horseshoe with the symbolic dynamics. And again, from the papers that I mentioned before, we could relate this topological horseshoe, that we will say that if F is a topological horseshoe for two set and zero and then one, and if we consider sigma 2, that is an infinite sequence of 0 and 1, and if we consider a map sigma from sigma 2 to sigma 2, that is a shift map, we could state that the map F is semi-conjugated to the shift map C. That this means that for any sequence of symbols 0 and 1, there exists an orbit generated by the map passing through the two sets and one and then two in the given or in the order given by the sequence. This is for any sequence, and this means that we could guarantee the existence of any kind of orbit, meaning a periodic orbit for any period or chaotic orbits, any kind of polar orbit, and so on. Okay, now we want to show how we apply this topological horseshoe in our Poincaré map. So starting again from, we come back to the Poincaré map that we have constructed, and we see again the plot that I showed before, where we have two hyperbolic fixed points with their respectively stable in blue and unstable in red manifolds. Now we want to find two sets that are support of each set containing Q1 and Q2 that are a topological horseshoe for the map P. We found them in an explicit way. So if we now we pass to the plot on the left, okay, we have the two points Q1 and Q2, and we construct explicitly the two sets N1 and N2. Let me show how we construct, for example, N1. We take the parallelogram where the edges are parallel to the stable and unstable eigenvector related to the fixed point. So we found some interval, we could write the parallelogram in this form, so Q1 plus a real interval multiplied by the direction of table plus another real interval B1 times the unstable eigenvector. So we found, for example, this set N1. And if we evolve the set N1 under the map, the Poincaré map P that we have, what happens is this parallelogram will be stretched. In particular, it will be stretched, it will be expanded in the direction of the unstable manifold, and it will be contracted in the direction of the stable manifold. So this set is the image of the set N1 under the map P. So what we have done is to find these two sets N2 one such that after such that they P recover both itself and the other set. So in this figure we could see that the hypothesis of the horseshoe is satisfied. So we have proved that we found the topological horseshoe for our map. This proved the existence of the horseshoe for the map P, the existence of symbolic dynamics for our map P. Okay, so the conclusion of this work is that we have highlighted the existence of this topological horseshoe in the face portrait of the secular binary asteroid system interacting with an exterior planet. The work could be continued, and in the future we would like, maybe the work is purely numerical, and we would like also to prove this existence with a computer assisted proof. Then we would like also to give an analysis with different values of the parameters, because as I said before, we have fixed the parameters, the constant of this problem. So all the study is done with one particular set of parameters. Then we would like to study the spatial case, because we study only the planar case. And moreover, we would like to study the full problem, not just the circular one. Finally, another very important problem is to analyze the case where the orbit of the planet is not external, as in our case, but it is internal to the ones of the asteroids. It's a very interesting problem, because it changed the phase space is completely changed when we choose the planet inside the orbit of the asteroids. Well, I have, here there are some references that I mentioned during the talk, and that's it. I complete my talk.
Thank you very much, Sara.
You're welcome. Right.
I think that if anyone has a question, he can unmute himself and...
Marco, also?
Yeah.
Very interesting, Sara. Thank you. Just one question. When you go up to the Poincaré surface section,
yes,
we see G versus G small. G is the angular momentum, so I understand that those orbits which are prograde with positive angular momentum have a way larger possibility of being chaotic than those which are retrograde with negative angular momentum. Is that true?
Yes, it is negative, because we are taking the projection, so it could be negative. Yes, the fact is that the question is if it is possible that there are chaotic.
If you have any explanation for that, I mean, why is it that the chaotic part of the phase space shows mostly in the prograde?
Yeah, I understood the question now. I don't have an answer. Yeah, it is. Yes, it's a good point to think about why. Of course, it is the chaos. The mass of the chaos is close to going to minus lambda and plus lambda. The system become more chaotic. Mm-hmm. But why the most of them are in the prograde motion? I cannot answer.
Any other questions?
I will think about it. Thank you very much.
Sara, Francesco Fasso.
Yeah.
I have a couple of questions, very simple questions actually. Let's ask the two of them. The first one is, at the very beginning, you have this parameter M0.
At the beginning, X0?
M0, the mass.
The mass, yes.
And, then in the second formula, in the second line that you're showing now, You yes. could get rid, I think that you could get rid of M0 with a time rescaling. And instead you take it, this parameter, you use it in the change of coordinates, of the Delaunay coordinates, and only after that you put M0 equal 1. So the question is whether, maybe I'm wrong, but if there is a specific reason.
No, I don't. We put M0 just at the end when we choose when we choose the orbit.
Yes.
Because in this problem, M0 is generic.
Now in the full problem, you yeah. cannot rescale M0 out, but the reason I think it's because M0 entered the Delaunay transformation. In the,
yes.
in the original Hamiltonian, M0 can be rescaled. I think you just have to rescale the momenta or the time. Because you see, there is M squared zero over the axis and one over M0 multiplied by the y's.
Yes, but it is done, this rescaling, so the choice of beta, beta bar written this way, so this rescaling is done in order to have here one, and here there is sigma. Just it is done in order to have these two terms with this coefficient. I don't know if I answer. Okay, all the step that we have of the passage in order to have this starting from this one, and then passing to the Hamiltonian written the Delaunay variables. Our aim was to get this kind of Hamiltonian, so where the in y, in x and y, we just have this Keplerian part.
Okay, yeah. Okay,
Gabriella, oh yes, okay,
it's just for dimensional reason.
Yeah, okay. Thanks.
No, okay, so,
sorry.
Okay, so thank you. But okay. Then the other question is maybe because so you had a lot of fixed points in the chaotic region.
Yes.
So the question is, how did you got those?
We got them, yeah.
Those points.
Yeah, we got them with a Newton algorithm. Just with a Newton algorithm, we write in an explicit way the numerical derivative of the map P, and we apply a Newton algorithm in order to find the fixed point.
But you need a starting point. So how did you get the starting point?
Okay, the starting point are given, we did a very refined grid on the variables capital G and small g. So we take a grid on all the domain, and we we apply the Newton algorithm for all the initial condition in this grid.
Ah, okay.
Yes.
So I was wondering whether you had a clue because you could see small islands that we could not see in the picture.
Yeah, okay. In fact, we are not sure, we cannot say that all these points are all the possible fixed point found, because we could see that if we change, also if there are any of these points, if we start close to this point, we go again in the fixed point. But sometimes, for example, in order to find some of the elliptic point, we should take some initial guess close, very close, or we have to change the sites of the grid in order to find the, in fact, we do more than one process in order to find all of them. So it is not excluded that there are more fixed point, both elliptic and hyperbolic. We cannot ensure that they are all of them.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Can I make a question?
Yes.
Yeah. Alessandro. Yes.
Yes.
With reference to this figure, do you have non-twist curves anywhere in the plot? I couldn't see them, but I'm not sure that they are close to zero. For example, I don't know if the curves become more curly or not, and whether you lose the twist condition.
Okay. So the question is if if we have some curve that it is not
twist. That is, if you don't if you have non-twist maps, I don't know, because you can make also an analytical study, of course, to find whether you have the twist condition everywhere.
I cannot answer.
Well, this is a suggestion. And another suggestion is.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, another suggestion is for you. So thanks for the nice talk, and thanks also to Gabriele and Jerome. I see that your program is very ambitious to include also the non-secular problem as well as the inclined problem. Nevertheless, I would suggest also to consider the case where you have an oblate planet.
Okay.
Okay, in that case, you can consider some approximations, for example, limiting to the J2 problem. You can make averages. So the essential features of the dynamics will be the same as in your problem, but maybe that you had that the oblateness of the body, that is the J2, the expansion spherical harmonics, will influence the dynamics, hence the hyperbolic structure, the, and all the other things that you showed today. So this is the suggestion.
Okay, thank you very much.
Of course, if Jerome and Gabriella want to add something, they are welcome, of course.
Yeah.
I have a curiosity. I'm Susanna Terracini.
Yes.
Hi. You mentioned that you wish to extend these results to the spatial case.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So in that in for higher dimensional systems, these let's say simple topological schema by Zieglinski that you exposed earlier can be in fact extended, but with some difficulties. Do you have any ideas already of the topological tools that could be used for proving dynamic symbolic dynamics in three dimensions?
But in the papers by Gide and Zieglinski, it is from a theoretical point of view, it is done also for an n-dimensional problem. Because the definition of this definition, I really simplified here this definition because we are just near two, but there are they hold and also the theorem of symbolic dynamics hold also for
n-dimensional set. Okay, so it's not restricted to the, this is not two-dimensional.
This is just a simplified version. Of their theorem. Yes, this is the theorem is just a simplified version.
I see. So you already have the topological tool to prove the symbolic dynamics.
Yes, it is an idea to use again the topological horseshoe. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Are there any other questions?
I have.
Yeah. There you go.
Well, so first of all, I would ensure you that the technical issue, the technical result outcome of your talk was nearly perfect. So it seems that everything is okay, and probably also for next seminars it will be as good as today. Well, I have a question that I'm used to raise when I listen this kind of results, usually by Polish people on computer assisted proofs.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so you have put your hands in this machinery that is mainly on symbolic dynamics, and this is used also to prove the diffusion in some mm-hmm. problems. Okay. And there's a crucial point from a physical point of view
mm-hmm.
that is the time of the diffusion. And often the emphasis of all this machinery is just symbolic, and they do not care too much about the transition time between one status and another one, okay? In order to make a chain of transition from a region of the phase space to another,
mm-hmm.
okay? Did you have some feeling about this time of transition when you are studying this procedure, or well, it is completely lost and it is just a proof of existence of some orbits without any estimate of the diffusion time?
Okay. Well, we have. I'm thinking about the answer. At the beginning, we have not idea about this time, but maybe if I well understand the question, what we have seen. Also, we have also studied the FLI of the face the face portrait, and what of course we have seen that okay the FLI confirm this kind of portrait, and we have some intuition about this time, because for example the orbit, the chaos obtained in the upper part become rise before that the chaos in the lower part, so we have seen that there is a difference between the orbit and between the region, how also the chaos coming from this part around this elliptic island, this one, it is not, we couldn't see it with the FLI with the same time where we see the part, the one in the upper part. I don't know if
So you have indications about the transition time, the diffusion time,
yes.
but
we
by another numerical tool.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. I'd like to add, if I can, Sarah, just two comments concerning Ugo and Alessandra. Ugo, this is a 2 degrees of freedom system. So in this specific case, we do not expect diffusion. Maybe we could have, once we switch to the full problem or to the spatial problem, but here we have 2 degrees of freedom.
I was meaning from one state to another state, which is the time needed to reach, you know, you have a symbolic state at the beginning and then another one at the end. Have you some indication of the transition time between the
No, we have not considered
this, was the question.
This problem. And also the reason why we were interested to this problem was originated from that paper that was mentioned by Sarah on celestial mechanics. So the curiosity was whether it was possible to find into the three-body problem certain orbits that could be considered continuations of certain other orbits of the two fixed center problems because of a relation of an integrability relation of the averaged two center problem. Which means that here, if you switch off the kinetic energy of one of the two asteroids, you have a two center, an average the two center problem, which is integrable. And you know very well its phase portrait. So the curiosity was whether once you add the kinetic energy, if it is possible to consider this kinetic energy in some region of the phase space, a small perturbation of the average the two center problem, and to have a phase space that more or less is comparable to the one of the two center problem. And this picture show that this is not the case. So this was at least my curiosity in this problem. So Alessandra's suggestion is welcome to consider the oblateness, of course. But at least my initial curiosity was this one. So that's all.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.